Good morning, Americas. Good afternoon, Europe. And good evening, Asia Pacific. I hope you're staying safe and healthy, and I'm happy to welcome you to our live stream event today. I'll be your host, Dan Willetts, Global Account Executive at Henkel. Our focus today will be on the role material solutions play in advancing the growth of future vehicles, with a particular focus on electric vehicles. As a new electric vehicle owner myself, I can appreciate the importance of the changes we're all experiencing in the market. Before we get underway, I'd like to share a little background on Henkel in case you're unfamiliar with us. Henkel is 144 years old with more than 53,000 employees worldwide, spread across three business units, including Adhesive Technologies, Beauty Care, and Laundry and Home Care. A few of our leading brands include Loctite, Persil, and Schwarzkopf. Within Adhesive Technologies, we support packaging and consumer goods, automotive and metals, industrial and electronics, craftsman, construction, and professional markets. Within the automotive industry, you can find us on more than 90% of the vehicles made today, serving over 8,000 customer sites. Our 15 global product development centers are closely located to major automotive facilities around the world, which gives us the ability to support your needs anywhere at any time. In addition to our technology centers, more than 50 adhesive manufacturing sites and over 500 technical support engineers ensure customer trials and commercialization run smoothly from start of production or product launch to full production scale up. But clearly, today's engineering environment is about so much more than physical proximity. Our ability to accelerate and optimize vehicle design remotely is key to success, which is why Henkel provides full part design in-house with CAD and CAE simulation, 3D printing and prototyping capabilities to speed up production trials, on-site product testing support through NVH labs and full vehicle ovens. And that support is offered across the value chain in key market segments of the vehicle. While there are many technologies in our portfolio to choose from, together they help deliver common benefits for the industry at large, including lightweighting, sustainability, safety, comfort, and cost. From a manufacturing perspective, they also help increase efficiency throughout the production process, from planning and validation to launch and series production. Switching gears to the state of our industry today, we're certainly in the middle of a significant and exciting shift. IHS predicts there'll be 18 million electric vehicles in global production by 2024. Completely changing the way we design and manufacture vehicles. The increase of vehicle electronics is also driving another key trend, advanced driver assistance systems. Predicted to be a $70 billion industry by 2025, ADAS-related sensors will help interpret a vehicle's surroundings to ensure smart mobility. As the market moves further toward these next-generation vehicles, material solution knowledge across the full value chain becomes increasingly essential. But as we scale up the introduction of electric vehicles and increase the use of vehicle electronics, the need to offset this added weight becomes increasingly important. Our portfolio of solutions helps our customers design vehicles with mixed materials that not only meet crash and performance standards, we also help to accomplish these designs at the lowest total cost. And that's where material solution knowledge across the full value chain is essential. That's because in order to produce reliable, scalable, lightweight, and performance-ready vehicles, chemistry application must be fully optimized in every stage. Proper metalworking fluids, for example, improve adhesive and pretreatment performance throughout the production. At the other end of the value chain, assembly adhesives such as liquid gasketing, potting, and structural bonding ensure long-term performance. But our focus for today's live stream will be on how chemistry enables a no-compromise approach to battery electric vehicle design and manufacturing, with technologies and processes in the body shop and paint shop that help to protect the vehicle and EV battery during crash, optimize vehicle design, ensure lifetime reliability and longer EV battery range, offset vehicle weight, and deliver a comfortable driving experience. So without further delay, I'm happy to get us started. Our Henkel Innovation correspondent, Oliver Darrow, had a chance to catch up with several of our technology experts to cover some of these and most important material solution topics facing the industry today. You'll see highlights from these interviews in a series of three segments. Segment one will be on no compromise body shop solutions. Segment two will focus on optimizing vehicle body design through an industry partnership we formed called the Mobility Alliance. Segment three will review next generation paint adhesion for multi-metal substrates. If you have a question, feel free to enter it in the questions area at your control panel at any time during the broadcast. Following each segment, my European colleague, Luke Van Camp, will moderate your questions live with our experts. We'll also have an extended Q&A after the live stream for continued discussion. And now I'll turn it over to Oliver for the first segment featuring Mark Zaradnik, our head of commercial engineering for the Americas.
Well, hello, Mark, and thank you very much for joining me today. We're going to talk about how material solutions in the body shop are influencing future vehicle development. So that's fascinating. I'm going to ask my first question. Why are body shop material solutions important for next generation vehicles? I'm just curious.
Yeah, well, they meet the competing requirements of reducing weight and improving performance. So nowadays, you know, offsetting the vehicle weight's more important than ever, especially with EVs and the electronic sensors that are involved. We know that they're increasing from 100 to 600 sensors in these vehicles, as well as the battery adding between 600 to 800 kgs of weight. So these materials, in addition, they offer a lot of compatibility with the newer materials that are being used in these vehicles, and they reduce weight while meeting or exceeding crash and performance requirements. Also, they can help achieve manufacturing and design flexibility while reducing investment costs. Things like for structural adhesives, they can reduce the number of rivets and welds. You can consolidate some of your body shop materials as well as meet varying design requirements. And lastly, and very importantly, we can reduce some warranty costs by really protecting the vehicle from external influences that can decrease reliability or even lead to failures.
You mentioned structural adhesives. What benefits do structural adhesives offer?
Yeah, some of the key benefits that it offers over things like mechanical joining methods like rivets and spot welding is you can actually reduce these elements by 6% on average. You can increase energy absorption, corrosion resistance, you can distribute stress better, improve your stiffness. So there's a lot of benefits there, but as well as some of these lightweight materials, you can join ultra high strength steel, aluminum, magnesium, carbon fiber, as well as a broad range of application areas in the body and white panels, pillar joints, front end carriers, wheel wells, and reinforcements, just to name a few.
So with regards to vehicle crash worthiness, can you please tell me about the benefits of structural adhesives in relation to crash worthiness?
Yes, actually crash performance and overall safety are very much improved with the use of structural adhesives. And really with the proliferation of electric vehicles into OEM fleets, it also requires more structural adhesives for bonding around the battery and battery enclosure. And they can actually deliver improved car body stiffness to protect the battery during crash events and even, you know, up to 25% of absorption compared to rivets and welds. And these adhesively bonded flanges, they absorb more energy across the bond line and distribute the loads better. They can remain closed or close longer during these crash events compared to mechanical joining and reduce bodily impact. They're proven across a wide range of substrates and testing scenarios, including in T-peel or impact wedge peel strength. And our next generation of adhesives demonstrate 100% cohesive failure for peel and shear testing, providing efficient transfer of energy to the substrate across a wide range of e-coat temperatures and environmental conditions.
So what about manufacturing and processability for structural adhesives? I'm curious.
Yeah, this is extremely important because we can have a great adhesive, but if it doesn't fit into the process, you know, it doesn't work well. So we're always looking to help increase our customers' efficiency in terms of being able to scale up electric vehicles is big right now. So getting into some unknown areas in some cases. And so it's so important that they're compatible with the body shop processes and operations. And we want to enable our customers to consolidate the products wherever possible. And some of Henkel's next generation structural adhesives like Terrazon EP5150 It provides a single formulation for steel and aluminum bonding with optimal uncured and cured properties. And some of those uncured properties, like humidity resistance in case the adhesive has to sit around the plant for a shutdown, flammability for welding or wash-off resistance in the paint system. These materials, they have excellent properties to really be compatible with the process, but then their performance is also excellent in very difficult conditions like a minus 40 C impact wedge peel test or stress durability, which is really an indication of long-term performance.
So Mark, will a differentiated portfolio, if I can call it that, of structural adhesives continue to be important?
Absolutely. Broad and differentiated portfolio, it's essential because every structural adhesive application has a unique need. And it, so it really depends on where it's found in the vehicle and which performance requirements need to be met. And we really do take a lot of factors into account when we're determining the ideal structural adhesive formula. This would include crash performance, stiffness requirements, and environmental conditions. Epoxies are traditionally used for these types of products because they provide high strength, ability to bond to oily metals, resistance to e-coat oven temperatures, and we will add toughening agents to these epoxies to make them more flexible and better suited to absorb crash impact energy.
Can you tell us about the benefits of panel reinforcements and structural tapes for next generation vehicles?
Yeah, certainly. Yeah, so these technologies, they help stiffen the body panels, thin metal sections, or any high stress areas. And they can offer compatibility in a variety of metal types, most commonly steel and aluminum. Also, design flexibility is a key factor. We have low, medium, and high expansion to fill a variety of cavity and gap sizes. And once they're fully cured, they increase stiffness and fatigue limits and just overall strength.
So can you tell me what are typical application areas for panel reinforcements and structural tapes?
Yeah, so traditionally, these types of products are in window frames, pillars, rocker, and rail sections. And we have custom die cuts. These are developed to meet the exact needs of our customers' specific designs. And the locations for these reinforcements include a door panel, hoods, fenders, body side outers, and roof panels. The panel reinforcements, they can help decrease the panel deformation, and they use a sandwich design where first you have a fiberglass reinforcement layer on the outside with the epoxy in the middle, and it bonds to the metal substrate down below.
Do you think that structural inserts are critical to next generation vehicles?
Absolutely. They really help deliver an optimal safety and performance at the lowest weight possible. And these structural inserts are, they're just light by nature because they're reinforced plastics with high performance structural foams, but they're very strong, enabling reduced panel thickness or part complexity and improve stiffness, strength, noise, and crash performance.
Can you tell me where they are located and just how do they deliver design flexibility?
Yeah, they're located all over, but primarily, you know, pillars, rockers, rails, frames, body panels, and others. And they also provide a lot of design flexibility with the expansion range of 60% up to 300% after they're actually expanded in the e-coat oven. And they also are very flexible in terms of part fixation. We can use traditional fasteners, weld tabs, or even structural adhesives to fixate those.
So how do you evaluate the application of structural inserts?
Well, first of all, Henkel's partnered with RLE International. This is a multinational engineering company, and we call the partnership with them the Mobility Alliance. What we do is we have a cross-functional team from Henkel and RLE, and we evaluate each application, develop a solution, and launch that into serial production. And some of the things that we look at as we're designing these parts, we will look at reduction of the substrate thickness, perhaps we'll select a different substrate, as well as we'll optimize a stamping for either lowering the cost or reducing its weight. But we're always, we're striving to hit that balance of reducing weight, lowering overall cost, and of course, meeting performance requirements.
So let's shift to metal downgauging. Can you tell me more about metal downgauging, please?
Certainly. So traditionally, extra steel is added for reinforcement, and the structural inserts, they help eliminate the need for that. So through simulation, we can precisely pinpoint where body crumpling may occur. We can downgauge that steel and add structural inserts to provide the reinforcement. And studies do show that this saves weight while overperforming in strength to weight ratio.
So how do you move from the design phase to the production of structural inserts?
Yeah, first of all, we work very closely with our customers. We collaborate, we evaluate the existing design. Then we start using our CAD and CAE evaluations to optimize and validate the design. We determine the performance that we need, the reliability and behavior across a wide variety of conditions. We identify the areas of potential improvement, and then we address challenges early in that design phase is really what we want to do versus fixing them later, you know, say when timing's compressed closer to launch, and an add-on solution at that time would actually be more expensive. So we want to really do that early in the design process and make sure we have the right solution in there for our customer. And in order to also save more time and money during the development stages, is we use 3D printing to print prototype inserts as well as cavities. We can do all that printing here at our labs in Madison Heights, Michigan. And after we've validated everything and have the full design optimization, then we move to serial production of that part.
So let's talk about sealants and acoustic solutions. Can you explain why they are important for next generation vehicles?
Yeah, certainly. So we have certainly under advanced vehicle technology design, more performance is required. And that performance can be compromised if those components are exposed to harmful environmental elements. So the sealants will prevent water and dirt and other contaminants from damaging components and systems and ensure reliability and long-term performance. And then the acoustic materials, they can help deliver a quieter driving experience. And especially now, since there's no significant noise from an EV powertrain to cover up surrounding sounds, it's more important than ever that body and white air leakage is managed properly.
So exactly how do acoustic baffles and tapes contribute to improved design flexibility and cost?
So acoustic baffles and tapes conceal a broad range of cavity sizes, and they're more varied now due to the integration of multi-materials and new designs. So the acoustic tapes, they can fill cavities between, say, 1.4 to 22 millimeters, and the baffles conceal larger cavities and gaps that are greater than 25 millimeters. And they're very flexible in terms of the expansion, where the baffles are going between 400% to 2500%, and the acoustic tapes from 200% to 1000%. And we do have some pumpable versions as well for pillar fillers. And really from a cost perspective, the Henkel baffles can achieve a variety of expansions from one single material, improving the design and manufacturing flexibility and robustness, and really helping to drive down and reduce tooling investment.
Can you tell me anything more about the benefits provided by body shop sealants?
You know, sealing's important for all vehicles, but especially in EVs, you know, the batteries can extend across most of the wheelbase area. So if a leak occurs, it could reach and degrade battery performance. And so these sealants are preventing the fluids from entering the assemblies and enclosures, and they're used everywhere in the vehicle. Floor pans, rocker panels, dash panels, you name it. And they seal seams and welds, and they can expand anywhere from 0 to 300%. But they also provide a lot of manufacturing flexibility, you know, available in pumpable and extruded forms. And they can really conform to different body contours and shapes and meet varying design needs. We can dispense these, make these as strips, custom die cuts, and we can really match it to the bond area. And they really do have a nice clean appearance without holes or stress concentrations, and they do seal against leaks and corrosion. And certainly one important thing, we talk about processability, they're wash off resistant, so they're not causing any issues in the paint process.
So Mark, why don't you join me here in projecting into the future?
Sure.
Explain to me what you think the future of sealants is.
What we're doing here at Henkel is we're moving toward the use of smart technologies for baffles and tapes. And it's pretty neat because what we do is we have expansion is based on the changes in pressure in the cavity you know, as that material is expanding. And what this enables is it enables more of a universal part design to reduce costs. So instead of having unique parts, you could use the same part in multiple locations You'll have fewer dimensional related engineering design changes. You can make your parts smaller to reduce your costs and just overall complexity reduction.
So NVH, noise, vibration, harshness, that's always an issue. Can you talk to me about the pumpable solutions that Henkel offers for NVH?
Yeah, some of our key pumpable solutions to reduce NVH in the body shop include our anti-flutter, high-damping foam, and liquid-applied sound deadeners. These are primarily used to reduce vibration and unwanted noise in key areas in the vehicle, such as doors and roofs, and floor assemblies in the case of LASD. And the technologies include rubber in the formulation, which enables a high degree of flexibility. So you've got lower strength compared to epoxies, but used where vibration damping and bond line read-through are prioritized over bond strength.
So anti-flutter, that's a phrase I don't hear very often. So tell me, Mark, why is anti-flutter and high-damping foam more important than ever in today's vehicles?
So yeah, as we're lightweighting and we're using thinner material, the exterior panels are more likely to experience unwanted movements from wind resistance, and this can cause noise in the vehicle cabin. So these exterior panels often have a large unsupported area, say in the roof or the door outers, and the anti-flutter foam, it helps limit the movement of the outer panel, while the high damping foam, it further dampens the movement for improved NVH. This absorbs vibration, it reduces potential for the adhesive read-through and anything that could possibly distort the exterior Class A surface. And we use simulation-based engineering that helps us to fully optimize the benefits of HDF. We can apply less material and maximize the NVH properties.
Mark, this has been a very enlightening and thorough discussion. Thank you very much for taking the time to talk with us today. Is there anything that you'd like to share in a closing remark?
Yes, really, you know, Henkel is solving mechanical challenges with chemistry and enabling our customers to blaze a trail towards the future when it comes to body in white development. And this includes design and manufacturing flexibility, weight reduction, safety, comfort, and cost.
That's excellent. Thank you.
Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this first segment. And as Dan mentioned, I'm Luc van Kamp, and I'll be moderating your questions today, live stream from Düsseldorf in Europe. We're joined now with both Mark Zrednik and another colleague from our commercial engineering department, Mark Whaley, to answer your questions on our body shop solution segment. Hello. First question I have, and I guess Mark Whaley, you can answer this one. How do structural adhesives help meet vehicle manufacturing needs before and after curing in the E-coat oven?
Okay, yeah, I'll take that one. Beforehand, in the body shop, these materials are made so that they're very compatible with our with the processes, you know, our customers' processes. So they have longer shelf lives, open time in terms of resistance to humidity, so that they can actually be out in the ambient temperatures and humidity for a while before they're actually assembled and cured. So they're very easy to work with in the actual body shop. They're very compatible with all the processes in terms of going through the paint shop, and they stay where they're supposed to stay. They don't get washed out of those joints. So prior to cure, it's very important that these materials are just very easy to use. And then after cure, of course, we really need to meet our customers' requirements in terms of whether it's for stiffness or crash, make sure that we have the right failure modes, you know, as those parts are tested in our customers' vehicles.
Okay, thank you very much. Next question that came in is the electrodeposition paint coating required in the location where the structural insert are used?
Yeah, and we could talk about that, but typically what the question is do you need E-coat in the areas where the expandable epoxy is going to bond? And yeah, we do have it either way. We have it where they can bond to the oily metal, mm-hmm. Or they can bond to the E-coat. So either way, you're safe. Do you have any other?
Yeah, I was gonna say, depending on the customer specification, some specifications call for you know, the E-coat to be bare, so basically cold rolled steel, and we have to do all our corrosion testing and everything to that, and we do test for corrosion in that case. But it all depends on our customer's requirements from the specification, but it is not needed in most cases for structural adhesives.
Thank you very much, Mark. I got a specific question on the material EP5150. Is this an OEM manufacturing Henkel solution or a new aftermarket body shop product?
Yeah, this is a new OEM solution that was developed specifically, kind of like what I talked about before, specifically to make sure that this really fits well into the body shop applications at the OEM assembly plant. You know, certainly, typically, I think what the question's saying is it for repair? And normally for repair, you need a product that doesn't need to see high heat. So something a lot of times like a two component epoxy. So those are different products that we have in our product line, but the 5150 is intended for actually assembling a vehicle, you know, in an assembly plant for the first time.
Thank you very much. Mark Zarudnik, I come back to you. So can you tell me more about the difference between adhesive failure and cohesive failure and why that difference is so important?
Yes. So adhesive failure, so if we take a lap shear, for example, just kind of demonstrating. So a lap shear assembly that gets pulled, adhesive failure, you would see the adhesive on one side and then no adhesive on the other. So we would consider that an adhesive failure. Cohesive failure, same thing, lap shear, you pull it, you would see adhesive on both sides. And so typically you do want to see a cohesive failure. A cohesive failure is much more predictable. You can model cohesive failures much better. Your scatter is, you know, it's much smaller, repeatability. So that's some of the reasons why you want cohesive failure. Also, there are other advantages in terms of when you have a cohesive failure, you get better transfer of loads, say during a crash event, to help dissipate that energy, as well as you do have some corrosion protection as well, ensuring that if there's any local failure of a bond for whatever reason, that you do have the adhesive on both sides and it's protecting those substrates and you're preventing corrosion in that area.
Thank you. I got a very easy question, I think, but I nevertheless leave it over to you, specialist. So can structural inserts, can they be reused after bake?
I can take that.
Yeah.
Reused, no, typically once the injection molded foam cures, it's locked in the place, so it can't be reused after bake. It's an interesting question, though. I'd be curious to learn the motive behind that, but no, they can't.
Okay, thank you. Can you discuss the benefits of structural adhesives over welds?
Yes. Yeah. So I'll take that question. So welds work well, you know, holding together an assembly, but what they do is they concentrate the stress in very localized areas. You can create some microfractures in those areas. So an adhesive will help spread that stress out along the entire bond area. So things like with fatigue, you'll notice, you know, better performance because of the fact that we are spreading out those loads. And so that's really the main benefit is that, you know, in a, say, once again, in a crash event, the adhesive is going to help hold that assembly closed during that event and help really transfer the energy better than a weld that, and you actually saw a little bit in the video earlier, there was an animation where the joint will actually open up when you have a weld like this, whereas when you have an adhesive in there, it'll help just crumple that zone and allow it to stay together and transfer that load.
Thank you. Another interesting question is, can I weld through a cured adhesive?
No, that's something that you don't want to do. After it's cured, you wouldn't want to weld at that time.
Okay, thank you. Why is it beneficial to combine these weldings with the adhesives in the joints?
Yeah, the nice thing about the combination of the welds and the adhesive, they do complement each other quite well. So when you're assembling, you know, your sheet metal in the body shop, the welds will hold those assemblies together prior to the adhesive being cured, so that adhesive won't cure until it sees, say, E-coat oven temperatures. So that's where the welds really come in. And so that's typically, and for the performance as well, you know, we do see that, you know, if you do have some welds in there with the adhesive, that typically is the best case scenario.
Thank you, Mark. I got a long question from the audience. Advanced structural adhesive in weld bonding application allow for increased pitch of spot welds or mechanical fasteners. What is the largest realistic OEM pitch that can be achieved with your advanced structural adhesive?
Yeah, that's a good question. That's a difficult one to answer. I'd like to actually get your information and let's talk about that a little bit more, because it really depends, you know, on the joint design, very application specific. So let's have that conversation.
Okay, we will get in touch with the person who has asked for this question. Is there a way that Henkel could support the customer improving their actual baffles, structural inserts and tapes in order to save money or reduce weight?
Yes, and we could answer that together. Sure. But yeah, that's something that we do, you know, with our customers. You know, having, you know, lightweighting being a mega trend, that is something that we're always looking at in terms of, you know, what can we do to reduce weight, but then also that cost, and look at that, the overall system, you know, not just a small component, but, you know, overall system, you know, how we can drive down both cost and weight. And it's something that we'll talk a little bit more later, but yep. You know, we do a cost value analysis and show the bridge of everything involved in that system, so that we can really have good conversations about, you know, how we can, you know, whether we're reducing thickness or eliminating parts, using lighter weight materials, enabling the joining of mixed materials with adhesives, mm-hmm. for example. So there's a lot of different ways that we can impact, you know, cost and mass.
Yeah, and just to add a little bit on that specifically related to the structural portion of it is, like Mark mentioned, that there's many things we can do early on in the design phase to change the substrate quality, or like you said, eliminate parts or reduce the gauge of a particular sheet metal and provide a lightweighting solution and potentially even cost-saving solutions by introducing structural inserts and structural adhesives. So definitely an opportunity for that. And like Mark mentioned, we'll have some information about that in further segments.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks very much, Mark. We have time for one last question. So welding and E-coat are common for metals. What about composites? Fiber-reinforced plastic, how is the adhesive cured then?
Yeah, it depends on the process. You know, you can have, of course, some heat cure materials. We also have some materials that don't require heat. So, you know, it's important that we're matching the CTEs of what we're bonding, making sure that we're not exceeding any temperature limits of any of the substrates. So we'd have to look at the exact materials and the exact process and determine, you know, how much heat that assembly could take, and if we want to do a, you know, single component heat cure material or a two component, you know, no heat type of a material.
I would like to thank you for these great questions. And now we'll turn it over back to Mark Zaretnik, who will introduce us to the next segment.
Our next segment is going to be really fun. We talked a little bit about structural inserts in our first segment. Next, we're going to delve deeper into this subject and introduce you to a partnership Henkel recently launched with multinational engineering company RLE International called the Mobility Alliance. My colleague Mark Whaley will give you an immersive look into this partnership in action. We'll be back after this next segment to answer more of your questions, so keep them coming.
So, Mark, how are you today?
Pretty good, Oliver. Yourself?
It's good to see you. Always nice to talk about innovation and technology and what Henkel's up to.
Definitely.
So this is new, the Mobility Alliance. It has a ring to it, but can you tell us what the Mobility Alliance is, please?
Sure, Oliver. Basically, back in 2018, Henkel and RLE formed what we call the Mobility Alliance. It's the combination of Henkel's expertise in material science and RLE's expertise in engineering. And the partnership focuses on optimizing vehicle components at the very early stages in the design process. The intent is to deliver the lightest weight, most cost-effective designs while still meeting the performance and safety requirements associated with the OEM. We plan to do this by using RLE's engineering expertise and Henkel's advanced structural solutions, which include structural inserts, panel reinforcement, structural tapes, and structural adhesives.
Why is this partnership between Henkel and RLE so relevant to the industry, particularly at this time?
As you know, the adoption of the battery electric vehicle is growing at a significant rate right now. The body in white plays an extremely important role as it represents one of the largest potential areas for weight savings on the vehicle. While we want to achieve the most weight savings possible, we don't want to compromise safety or the performance of the vehicle. The Alliance helps accomplish both those goals. It allows us to maximize weight savings while ensuring the protection of the battery, electronic components, and the overall vehicle is protected in the event of a crash.
Yeah, that's a delicate balance, using the lightweight materials yet still maintaining a level of safety. Exactly at what point in the vehicle development process would you say this approach is most effective? Is it early on, midway, towards the end?
The best time is early on in the design phase. That's the point of where you can save the most amount of cost and the time. It can be used later in the development process, but it's much more difficult to save weight and cost at that time.
So I'm very curious, what kind of results have you seen using this approach, this process?
Sure. When we formed the Alliance, we did a pilot study on an eSUV, which was composed of 75% aluminum, 25% steel, and we were able to save 42 kilograms of weight while still meeting the crash and NVH performance targets by using structural inserts, structural adhesives, and structural patches. We did modify several of the key components within the vehicle, such as the rocker, front bumper, the A and B pillars, rear floor members, and doors.
So Mark, are you able to give me an example of this process at work?
One example I can talk about, Oliver, is a body side example. In that example, we reduced the thickness of the body side outer and we added some structural reinforcement patches, and we were able to achieve significant weight savings and still met the stiffness requirements associated with the vehicle. Another example was on the rocker, where we replaced some heavier crush cans with structural inserts, and we were able to reduce weight and also meet the requirements for crash. We did all these optimizations using FEA and CA analysis and different engineering techniques. This helped us predict the structural behavior of the designs and also confirm that our designs met targets, but also were optimized for cost and performance.
Well, Mark, all this innovation is very interesting. It's very fascinating. I want to thank you.
No problem.
And I understand that Henkel has created a virtual reality experience to help engineers visualize the advantages of designing with the Mobility Alliance. Is that something that you can share with us today?
Absolutely.
Oh, that'd be
Absolutely.
Great. Okay, great. Let's take a look at that.
Sounds great. Here we are in the Mobility Alliance VR experience. Behind me, you can see our virtual test vehicle. In the next few minutes, we'll get up close with a few crash simulations from actual Mobility Alliance tests. You'll see how our design enhancements can improve your lightweighting, safety, and performance efforts. Let's have a look. Front collisions account for more deaths and injuries than any other automobile accident type, making this a very important area of the vehicle to study when it comes to crash performance. In this particular simulation, we optimized the front bumper and inner seal to reduce weight. Then we added structural inserts, shown here in red, to provide reinforcements. Here's how it performed in the small overlap simulation. Our results showed full battery crash protection with no intrusion into the battery cells, allowing us to improve vehicle weight while still meeting industry standards of less than 150 millimeters front wall intrusion. In the side impact simulation, we optimized the geometry of the rocker ribs, again reducing weight, and added three structural inserts to the rocker. Let's step inside the vehicle and see how our improvements fared in the pole crash simulation. Wow, that feels impressive when you're standing where I am. And the testing results were even more impressive. We were well within the target of less than 10 millimeters intrusion to the battery housing, besting the original design by nearly 30%, while still reducing metal thickness to save weight. Now I'll step back out of the vehicle to show you the final simulation, the roof crush test. In this scenario, we maximize light weighting of the A and B pillars by reducing reinforcement thickness by 30%. Then we added two structural inserts to reinforce the weak areas. So how do we do with this test? Let's take a look. In this case, we achieved a strength to weight ratio value of 5.1. A value over 4 is the expectation in the premium OEM sector. As you've seen, our Mobility Alliance combines Arley's design, engineering expertise, and Henkel's structural solutions to match, or in some cases, exceed OEM design specifications. With this test vehicle, we are able to save 42 kilograms while achieving all the original performance requirements. We look forward to hearing about your structural design challenges and partnering with you to create solutions that meet or exceed your expectations.
We hope you enjoyed that animated experience. We're back now to answer your questions on our Mobility Alliance and what it can offer in terms of design optimization. Got a first question from the audience to Mark. Okay, there they are. Mark Whaley, how is structural insert part fixation done?
Sure. There's several different ways. We can use traditional push pins, molded in clips, rivets, also weld tabs. It's really dependent on the environment in which the parts need to be attached to for the particular OEM.
Okay, thank you. Another question is, how long on average does it take for an enhanced design to be developed?
Sure. Typically anywhere from 6 to 8 weeks is the timing that we'll provide. But once again, it's dependent on the complexity of the system that we're analyzing, and then what factors are going into play, how much metal needs to be optimized or changed. But 6 to 8 weeks is the typical timing.
Thank you. A specific question on RLE collaboration. Is this only valid for North America, or is it also globally?
No, that's a good question. The Mobility Alliance is a global initiative. So we have facilities, our locations across the globe. We have, obviously, here in North America. We have resources in Germany, the UK, India, and then in China. So we expand across the globe to support our customers.
Thank you. Specific question in production, how does the structural foam respond during automotive washing and phosphating? So the okay. Liquid processes.
Well, the uncured part, which is injection molded foam, the phosphate and E-coat baths don't have an effect on it. The material doesn't start to cure until it actually sees the E-coat oven, and after about 10 to 15 minutes, it starts expansion and curing in that system. But the wash and the rinse has no effect on the material.
Thank you. What is the kind of cost savings that are possible using this approach?
Sure. There's several different potential cost savings, and it really is beneficial if we get started early in the process with a particular OEM. So if we're able to get in at the early design phases, we can optimize the metal gauge, we can reduce the quality of different substrates, or even eliminate parts based on our analysis of the vehicle. So if we get involved early, we have a significant chance to offer cost savings by introducing structural inserts and structural adhesives.
Thank you, Mark. This one is a long question, so I will be slow on asking it. So RLE does engineering. Then that design is taken to the OEM to manufacture it, or does the OEM do their own design again? And is this more proof or principle for your adhesive?
I guess I'll try to answer this way, and if someone needs a follow-up question, please feel free to enter it in there. But it depends on the situation. If there's a specific issue that we're trying to address, then we'll take a look at it internally with the Mobility Alliance, where we'll evaluate the design situation. So there are particular customer performance criteria that we need to meet. We'll make the adjustment, and then we'll run the analysis within our system and then provide that information back to our OEM customer. If it's just a blank sheet of paper where it's a study, then it's a little bit more interactive, where we make suggestions and we get feedback from the customer. But typically most issues are there's a particular problem that we're addressing or we're trying to resolve, and we do most of the design work in-house.
Okay, I got a very short question, practical question. How are the inserts inserted? Manually?
Yes. Typically, yeah, they're hand inserted into whatever body cavity that they need to be fastened to meet the performance requirements. I haven't seen any robotically applied. Not saying it couldn't happen, but I just haven't seen any.
What are the most important takeaway from the OEM community in the relation to the Mobility Alliance?
I think the most important thing that I would try to stress is getting involved early. Typically, the earlier we are involved with a process, our program is where we can bring more benefit. If we start up front, there are things that we can do from changing the sheet metal environment. Like I mentioned earlier about, you know, substrate quality reduction, down gauging, elimination of parts. It's a lot easier if you do that at the beginning of a process before you go ahead and tool up your different sheet metal panels. So that'd be the number one thing that I would stress, is getting involved early and looking at the entire system with the Mobility Alliance.
Okay. Is there any solution for repair of structural inserts in case of a crash, aftermarket solution? Is the EP1401, can it fill the big cavities?
I'm not particular with EP1401, but there are different aftermarket structural foams that we can apply. And I believe that is the correct one, 1401. Yeah. So there are aftermarket solutions to repair. So yes, that is the case.
Another question that is related to repair aftermarket. So are all the NVH products and tapes available for the aftermarket body repair shops so they can repair the vehicle back to the OEM original standards?
I mean, I can take a part of that, Mark. Sure. Yes is the simple answer, but most of our expandable tapes, our sealer parts, require some type of heat to actually cure. So in some cases, we may use a butyl patch or something to simulate what we actually do in the automotive assembly plant. But typically, that's worked out with the OEM directly on how we want to do a repair for aftermarket.
Yep.
Thank you. In which cases Henkel recommends the usage of structural inserts or tape instead of pumpable structural adhesive?
I think the simple answer is you want to use adhesives as often as you can from a solution standpoint. If you have the equipment and you have the facilities able, then a pumpable solution is probably the most cost effective. But there are times where you might not be able to do that, whether it's a PIA part where it has to transport from one facility to another, and a tape or a particular part may be better for transportation. Or you may not have the facilities to install pumpable and you need the actual physical part in there. But I would say in general, you'd want to use adhesives, but you use parts and when the need from a facilities or from an application standpoint is more prudent.
Thank you, Mark. Got a question on Zonderhof. I don't exactly know who can answer you this the best. But do you apply this Sonderhof, this acquisition that Henkel did some time ago, do you apply Sonderhof solutions, 2K and 1K polyurethanes in this field?
Yeah, well, see, those polyurethanes, typically that those wouldn't be going through the same process as what we're doing here with these like body shop materials. The Sonderhof products are typically handled by another Henkel team, and that's something that, you know, if you could provide us with your contact information, we can get back with you and have those conversations.
Thank you. And then I have the last question. So what's the current take rate of structural inserts designed in upcoming vehicles?
Depending on the OEM, there's some OEMs in North America that have 100% take rate. So I won't say 100%, I say 90% take rate. It's dependent on the OEM on what that take rate is. I'd say it ranges anywhere from, 10% to 80%. But the better interesting fact or concern is that if you design in and you work early in the process, that take rate is higher because you don't necessarily add costs when you're doing that. But after the fact, adding costs, that take rate varies by OEM.
Thank you very much, Mark. Now we'll head it back to Mark Zarednik, who will introduce us to the final segment.
Thank you. Yeah, it really is fascinating to see how much the industry is evolving and how chemistry plays a key role in that evolution. Our final segment of today will focus on how to pre-treat multi-metal materials in a way that is both sustainable and effective in terms of corrosion prevention. Our technical expert, Bob Miller, will take you through some exciting advancements in this area, and he'll join you live after the segment to answer your questions.
Bob, thank you for being with us today.
Thanks for having me.
So I understand there are some interesting things going on in the area of metal pre-treatment. So before we get into that, what are the traditional ways of metal pretreatment right now?
Well, zinc phosphate's the actual gold standard for metal pretreatment in the automotive industry. It's really effective for paint adhesion and corrosion prevention. There are some drawbacks with it, though. For instance, it contains heavy metals, zinc, nickel, and manganese, and it contains phosphate. There's also a significant energy to heat the bath. The bath is usually around 115 to 125 degrees. Even the low temperature baths are maybe 110, 105 degrees Fahrenheit. What that does is that actually uses a significant amount of water just from evaporation. There's other locations where water is also used. And then there's a maximum aluminum content, practically, of about 20 to 25% aluminum. With the high usage of aluminum today, can cause a problem.
So I'm curious, Bob, are there alternatives to zinc phosphate?
Yeah, we have a couple of alternatives. We have our Bondrite two-step process. We use that, or we recommend that, when aluminum content is usually between 20 and 85%. The first step would be a zinc phosphate on steel and galvanized steel. And then the aluminum would go through that system without any coating, and we would put a zirconium oxide coating on that in the second step. I mentioned before about the practical limitations of 20 to 25% aluminum. That's actually a chemical problem. And if we look at the first steps going through a zinc phosphate stage, we end up with a etch of the metal because of the acidity. Once we etch the metal, we have several other chemical reactions that go on. And sludge is, unfortunately, the byproduct that we don't want to have, but that we get. Aluminum sludges more than the other substrates, galvanized or cold rolled steel, significantly. It's about 2 to 5 times more than cold rolled steel, and it's actually 20 times more than the galvanized steel. So you can imagine a small increase in aluminum ends up being a large increase in the sludge. And that'll eventually overwhelm the filter process so that we end up having sludge on the car body as a defect. So what we need to do is we need to go in and we need to eliminate that aluminum dissolution, which is what our two-step does. Since we go through the zinc phosphate without etching very much of the aluminum, that allows us to have about two-thirds of the sludge decreased compared to a zinc phosphate.
Is it possible to treat up to 100% aluminum?
That's a great question, Oliver. We do that today at several of our customers, and we do that with our Bondrite thin film. We can treat up to 100% aluminum, or we can treat 0% aluminum. So it's got a flexibility to have whatever multi-metal mix we have, it works fine. It's got some great other benefits as well. It's a shorter line, which means that we're improving the processing time and costs, especially if there's going to be a new paint shop built. Customers who are using our thin film, they build the line specifically for the thin film, and they're eliminating stages and space and cost. There's also no heavy metals in our formulations, which means that we're running that heavy metal free, and it's phosphate free. We even have some customers that are using phosphate free cleaners, so now their whole system is phosphate free. So it's a fantastic thing for the environment. We also have significant reduction in the sludge that I was talking about. There really isn't any sludge with this system. We call it 80 to 90% sludge free, but really it's almost 100% sludge free. And then there's always our energy saving costs, which can be 70%, and our water savings costs, which can be up to 20%.
Are you able to walk us through the thin film process, just step by step?
Sure. There's four steps to that. The first step is going to be our cleaning step. In this step, we're removing oils, soils, other contaminants that are on the car body. We're going to first go through a spray system. In the spray system, we're removing the majority of all this oil and soils. And then we're going to go through an immersion stage, and that's going to take care of any interior cavities or inside the car itself where we can't reach with the sprays. If we have any major problems in cleaning, if it's not done optimally, we're going to see perhaps water break surface, we're going to see streaking, we may overclean and see smutting, and all these defects can cause poor adhesion performance. So what we want to do is make sure that we have optimal cleaning, especially on a thin film coating, where it's much thinner than on a zinc phosphate, and we etch the surface much less. So cleaning becomes a real important part of the process for thin film. We know a substrate is clean when the water exhibits a sheeting action and we have a water break free surface, as opposed to when it's not clean, we're going to get that water break surface, we're going to get streaking or smutting or other overcleaning products.
Okay, so what happens in step two?
Well, step two is just a water rinse, and that's essential so that we're removing all that water solution. The solution is alkaline. We need to make sure that the alkaline doesn't go into our pretreatment bath.
So tell me about the zirconium oxide stage. Do I have that right? Zirconium oxide?
Yes, that's correct. The goal is to convert this metal surface to that zirconium oxide coating. It's actually a chemical reaction so that that chemical outer layer of the substrate is zirconium oxide, which has fantastic adherence and corrosion performance for the paint. So we want to get to that oxide surface. There's some significant differences between a zinc phosphate conversion and a thin film conversion coating. The zinc phosphate's much thicker. We're talking about maybe 7 microns, which translates to 7,000 nanometers, whereas the zirconium oxide is only maybe 50 nanometers thick. So we're talking about 1/100th of a thickness of a coating. That shows up also in the coating weight. Also, when the zinc phosphate grows, it's going to grow into large crystals. So we have an extra conditioning stage that's required in order to make those crystals very small. And we'll get maybe a 7-micron crystal, and that's a good crystal, whereas in the zirconium oxide layer, it just naturally performs so that it forms a very small, very dense crystallization layer. If you look at a picture of a zinc phosphate, we're looking at it under a scanning electron microscope at maybe 1,000 times magnification to see those crystals. We have to go to better technology and maybe look at 20,000 times magnification in order to actually see the crystals in a thin film. It's that much smaller. So what that does is it significantly reduces our processing time and our costs. We're eliminating stages. And again, I'll mention, we virtually eliminate sludge. So that gives us the ability not to have to desludge, not to have to do boil outs or chemical cleaning of those stages from time to time. And it's a much, much better for costs and for maintenance.
So I'm guessing ultimately there's a final rinse, right?
Correct. We'll do a final rinse with a purified water. So we use either DI water or RO water, so that we don't have to worry about contamination. If we use city water or plant water, we might have sodium salts or other salts which can get under the paint if they're left on the surface, and then they may cause blistering in the future. And in order to check for that, we'll use conductivity during the plant running just to verify that the level of purification on those last stages is very good.
So what are the key areas of savings when using thin film, assuming there are savings?
Yeah, there are, Oliver. The annual cost savings are probably between 20 and 40% when you take into account all the factors that are accounted for. If you look at not just the chemistry, but you also look at the water savings, energy savings, we have waste disposal savings and water treatment savings, and we also have the manpower that's not required for some of the additional steps in zinc phosphate, then we usually see about a 20 to 40% cost savings for our customers. I have had customers that have seen over $500,000 a year savings.
That's pretty significant. Well, this has been a very enlightening conversation. I'm very glad you were able to share these things with us. Is there anything that you'd like to share with us as a final thought or conclusion?
My final conclusion is that it's a really exciting time for us here at Henkel in metal pretreatment in the automotive industry. We've been given the opportunity to work with our customers to introduce this new technology, which is really the biggest advance that we've seen in the time that I've been at Henkel in 30 years. And it's giving us the opportunity to deliver both cost savings and sustainability while really simplifying the whole manufacturing process for our customers.
It's excellent. Thank you for taking the time. Appreciate it.
Thanks. I appreciate the talk.
Thank you so much, Bob, for that interesting segment. We're happy to have you join us live now to answer the questions from our attendees. So let's take a look at some of the questions that have come in.
Okay.
So first question that I received is, how does the role of cleaning change when moving from zinc phosphate to tin film?
Good question. When we clean, that's always a very critical part of the process. For zinc phosphate, we're about 100 times thicker in coating, and we etch much more, as I mentioned in the video, than for a zirconium oxide. So cleaning becomes a lot more critical for zirconium oxide. We need to clean the surface well, and we need to make sure that it's rinsed off well before we go into the pretreat section. So we've actually at Henkel designed cleaners that are made specifically for zirconium oxide. It's such a critical part of the process.
Thank you. How difficult is it from a manufacturing perspective to transition from a zinc phosphate to tin film?
Some of our customers are making green sites and they're made specifically for zirconium oxide. If we have a line that's a zinc phosphate line and we're trying to convert it to a zirconium oxide line, which we do quite a bit, then we run into potential difficulties where we have large gaps between stages. Usually we have plenty of time for cleaning, the line's already set up for that, and plenty of time for the zirconium oxide stage. But we would eliminate some of the stages, which is nice. We eliminate the post-rinse stage, if we have a post-rinse, and we also eliminate the conditioner stage. So we've got two fewer stages that we have to deal with. Those will just become water rinse stages. And then for the cleaning, we just want to make sure that everything before and including the zirconium oxide stage, that we don't dry out the vehicle between the stages. Those are the main differences. We don't need heat, and we don't need as much filtration in the zirconium stage, so we may remove heat exchangers, and we may remove the large filter press just for small bag filters.
Thank you, Bob. Next question is this surface treatment done on shaped parts or also on plate metal?
The zirconium oxide for automotive is going to be done on a car body, obviously. The technology could be done on whatever parts we want to do it on. So we could do it on shaped parts or we could do it on flat parts.
Okay, thank you. Can you tell me more about how water savings are achieved?
Yeah. Well, the first thing we mentioned is we're eliminating some stages. So those stages, the post-rinse and the conditioner stage, are usually dumped and built up periodically. So we would eliminate having to dump and wastewater treat those stages, and then the water that would be used to build those up would no longer be used. Even the low temperature, if we're running a bath at 115 degrees Fahrenheit, that's going to actually evaporate quite a bit of water in these tanks. And when we go to zirconium oxide and run at room temperature, we get quite a bit of savings from evaporation savings. The water is not evaporated. We also have just rinse stages, and we optimize the rinse stages for counterflow so that we use the minimum amount of water that we need to. There are possibilities that we would use more RO or DI water, but overall water we would probably use much less. That's what we typically see when we change a line over.
Thank you. How is the performance of tin film compared to zinc phosphate?
That's a great question. Even our earliest modifications, we were passing specifications. I think that for aluminum and for zinc-coated steels, our performance is actually better in my mind from the data that I see. And the process is simpler and easier to control.
cold roll steel, our first process, our generation one. Our performance was passing spec, but a little bit weaker in some corrosion tests. Our last generation test results that I've seen looked really fantastic. So it's hard to say what is better. We might have 15 different tests, and 7 tests were better for the zirconium and 7 tests were better for the zinc phosphate. So they're very close to being equal at this point. And again, with a much simpler process.
Thanks, Bob. Another question that goes further on the wastewater treatment. So the sewage water of this kind of process, so the zirconium process, how does it affect the environment?
Well, we still do the same type of wastewater treatment before we would when we would dump a bath. So we are going to get metals that dissolve into the bath because it's an acidic bath, and we also have the cleaner, which is going to be the same type of cleaner involved in both cases. So we would do a pH adjustment, and we would precipitate out any heavy metals or any of the other elements that need to be precipitated out before going to drain.
Thank you. How do you see thin film progressing in the future?
That's a great question. Thin film is here. It's going to stay. Over 10% of car bodies globally are running thin film today. It's a little surprising to a lot of people. And I see in North America, for the U.S. and Canada, Henkel has a large share. And over 40-45% of our line, our car bodies, are actually thin film today. So we're running a lot of thin film in North America.
Okay. Does the thin film process reduce the amount of labor needed?
Yeah, we reduce labor and mostly in maintenance and in lab support. Again, if we're eliminating two stages, then we have two less stages that we're periodically dumping and rebuilding. We're also not having to do testing and adjustments in those two stages, which are no longer done. So those are some savings. We don't do annual boilouts because the zirconium oxide stage doesn't have the sludge, so it stays very clean, so there's less maintenance on a yearly case. So we have a lot less maintenance fees. We have a lot less lab adjusting, testing, because we're limiting stages, and the testing is pretty straightforward for the zirconium oxide. So we have a variety of ways that we're eliminating labor.
Thanks, Bob. And I guess this is the last question. No, there is another question that came in. So what about the application to magnesium substrates?
Yeah, thin film is applicable to magnesium. So we would still be able to run the zirconium oxide. It would be a better choice to use than it would be for a zinc phosphate. So again, magnesium would be okay too.
Okay, and then the final question. So what kind of troubleshooting support does Henkel offer with the metal pretreatment processes?
Well, for our thin film or for all our metal pretreatments, we offer the same type of technical expertise. First, we have a person in line 24 hours a day, and he's available 24 hours a day, and he's a technical expert for the first line of defense for any technical problems. And of course, he's a team member, so he's part of the paint shop team. He works with the entire paint shop team for any defects, any problems. And then as we need more support, we have a fantastic tech service staff. Those guys would, again, be available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They do a lot of travel, so if they are not able to help over the phone immediately, then they would come out and be on the line to help support that. And of course, we've got our entire technical research group and our business group that would also be involved for that. We also have a equipped laboratory where we would do a lot of analyses, go to our laboratories for either solution analyses or for paint defect analyses, where we would take a defective part, ship it off to the labs, and have the Henkel labs do analysis on that to look at the defect in very close and in a laboratory environment.
Bob, there is one very interesting question that came in my opinion at least. So in Latin America, a lot of processes are still phosphate, and we think that customers are thinking that the process of phosphate is more robust than zirconium. Is this correct?
Depends on how you label robust. The zinc phosphate process has been around for 100 years. It's a fantastic process. There's no doubts about that. What I found running zirconium oxide a lot for the last 8 years or so is that actually when you're running online, the zinc phosphate has very important control parameters in the conditioner and then in the free and total acid. And you want to make sure that you're getting a good crystal morphology. Everything has to work right. Zirconium oxide is very simple. So in a plant environment, zirconium oxide runs fantastic. It runs well all the time. There are very, very easy tests to run. There's very simple ways to increase or decrease coating weight if you need to increase and decrease coating weight. So in that respect, the zirconium oxide is probably more robust. If you then look at, for another way to look at robust, in terms of paint, the zirconium oxide is a little more sensitive to E-coat, so you need to make sure up front that you're doing the correct body preparation on panels and that you've got your bath set up correctly, and then you don't run into problems. But initially for startup, you do need to be a little more careful for the sensitivity for zirconium oxide. So more robust in some ways, less robust in other ways, like everything.
Thanks very much, Bob. And now I'd like to welcome back our host, Dan Wallets, as well as our other technical experts, Mark Zaretnik and Mark Whaley, and for the final portion of our Q&A. So for social distancing purposes, Mark Zaretnik and Mark Whaley will be joining us from separate offices. So we'll have about 20 minutes to cover any additional questions you may want to ask. First question is that I will go back to Bob on the thin film. So when is zirconium oxide film applied for multi-materials assemblies? So how, when is zirconium oxide film applied regarding multi-metals and multi-materials assemblies?
I'm thinking I understand that question. We would apply that in the paint shop. After body shop, the vehicle or the parts would go to a paint line and a pretreatment line. And in the pretreatment line, we would go through the process. All the metals would go through together or could go through together, or they could be batched. That's another nice thing about the zirconium oxide is you don't need to change the chemistry. If you change from 100% steel and then go to 100% aluminum or 100% galvanized, you might change how you maintain that chemistry slightly, but you wouldn't change the chemistry. I hope that answered the question.
Yeah. I got a question for Mark Zaretnik. So how do structural adhesive increase fatigue life?
Yes, structural adhesives improve fatigue life because what you get with spot welds is you get localized stresses that with vibration, you can get some actual micro cracking. And so with the adhesive in there, it will counteract that type of situation. So your fatigue life will improve tremendously using an adhesive versus just spot welds.
Okay, this is a question I think, Dan, you can better answer this one. What, in your opinion, are the most significant developments in material solutions over the past 5 to 10 years? And what will be the most significant changes in the coming years?
Luke, that's a great question. So as we've all seen, lightweighting is a huge topic. It's been that way for a long time, which brings in a bunch of different materials into the manufacturing process. So to make those materials work together and fit together, not only for manufacturing at our customer sites or the OEM assembly plants, but also for the long-term durability. So that is, it's created a ton of innovation. And then you go forward and electric vehicles. There's so much more that's coming in with new technologies, new sensors, different weights, and everything working together, not only in the vehicle, but also in on the streets. So if you look at different cities and how the car is gonna interact, not only in their own production processes, but with the environment and the different cities and all the other cars working together in vehicles. So I think this is huge, huge opportunity for everyone to bring in new ideas and new ways of doing business. Henkel is very good with that. So we have, as we said earlier, a lot of different technologies and a lot of different markets that we support. So when you take that knowledge and you put that together and you think about customers or ourselves as consumers, if we're going to drive an electric vehicle autonomous, you know, you need to really make sure that safety and comfort and reliability is there. So with all these new ideas coming forward, then I think our staff, our over 500 engineers working together all around the world, so we have a lot of diversity of thought and ideas, really makes us a strong partner for the market.
Thanks very much, Dan. Got a technical question for Mark, one of both Marks. So can you talk more about how next generation structural adhesive help consolidate body shop materials?
Yes, they can help consolidate the body shop materials by having the ability to bond to both steel and aluminum. So for example, you wouldn't need a separate aluminum bonder and a separate steel bonder. You know, that's one way. As well as, you know, perhaps you would have the opportunity to reduce some of the a structural adhesive type of a tape. You could replace some of those types of materials. So there are several opportunities in a body shop to, you know, take a next generation structural adhesive and have that replace some other products to simplify your process.
Thank you, Mark. Another question that comes back to the a little bit to the previous question, Dan. So how can Henkel help enable to scale up the electrical vehicle?
Well, we have a lot of R&D centers and we can do this remotely. So when Mark Whaley talked about our partnership with RLE called the Mobility Alliance, we have a large team of people that could work with you and your teams while you're designing these vehicles. Ideally upfront, so we can take cost and process steps and have the best solution upfront. But sometimes there's an issue that happens when you're launching a vehicle. We also have a quick force available at any point in time to give some very quick feedback. So, and enable with our 3D printing and other options like that to develop a solution on the fly that's going to meet the long-term standard. So Henkel is very open, and we have a large team that's been doing this type of work for many years. And we work with basically every automotive manufacturer out there. So like I said earlier, we're on over 90% of the vehicles on the road today. And we have many new ideas to help those vehicles and those customers get better reliability and safety, as well as cost reduction. So if we work together up front, we can get all those attributes as well as costs. Because let's be frank, when you look at all the new projects or programs that are happening, whether it's autonomous, it's electric, it's a EV or HEV, hybrid, fuel cell, there's a lot of different things competing for our thoughts and our energy and our cash. So if we work together up front, we could help to minimize that and get a better solution going forward in the future.
Thanks, Dan. Question that came in, what are the key ways Henkel supports OEM customers in troubleshooting?
So I could take that, Luke. Actually, any one of our experts here could take that. But when we have different issues that come up, and we, like Bob said earlier, we have a lot of people that are in your manufacturing plant today. So when something happens, we have a large history and database of information, what has gone wrong in the past, what were the solutions to help fix those problems. So typically what happens is someone will call someone from the key account team. So let's say Ford, for example, they would call me up and they'd say, we have an issue at this assembly plant with metal pretreatment. Something is going wrong. We're not sticking, the paint's not sticking or something like that. We would immediately get in touch with our plant rep, then ultimately with experts like Bob. If on the other side, if there's something going on and it's more of a future thing, okay, we have an issue, our vehicle, we need to take 10 kilos out of the weight of this vehicle. At the same time, we have to be able to hit all these government standards and regulations. what are we going to do? We would then bring Mark Zaradic or Mark Willey and that team together, maybe with RLE, maybe not, and look at your situation, the different materials that you're using, and use our industry-wide knowledge, because, I mean, we are strong at every part in the world. So we have a ton of knowledge at your fingertips that we would support you in trying to understand what that specific issue is with the specific expertise that Henkel has to offer.
Thanks, Dan. You mentioned previously about these 3D printing. So one person is asking, can you go a little bit more on details on what the capabilities are of 3D printing from at Henkel?
Yeah, Mark Whaley, do you want to cover that one, please?
Yeah. So the 3D printing, we have a lot of capabilities, in various locations, at Henkel facilities. Just for example, here in Madison Heights, Michigan, we have the capability to take your information, your CAD, and say, for example, print the actual cavities. So if we're in a situation where metal isn't available yet, we could actually print the cavity itself and then print our part. So whether it's a baffle or it's a structural insert, so we could print both of those parts, and then we can actually do validation testing of those 3D printed parts of the actual system itself, and get a lot of upfront information back to to our customer, to the team, that helps us to see what do we need to do with that part or that system. In terms of making sure that we're hitting all of the requirements that are necessary. So it's a really neat way to move very fast. I mean, that's the whole key of it, is move before we actually have tools made, move before we actually have actual cavities and sheet metal. It really gives us an advantage to develop on a very short timeline.
Thanks very much, Mark. Mark Whaley, I got a question which links to your presentation. So structural inserts technology is in the market for more than 10 years. And so from the cost perspective, how it's justified for a business case?
Sure. That's an excellent question. Because typically, if you use a structural insert as an add-on to address a problem that you're having in a current vehicle, it can be a cost. But what we're proposing is working with the different engineering teams at a much earlier phase in the design process to introduce structural inserts and structural adhesives, but by still altering the environment. So if we're able to, like I mentioned earlier, eliminate different brackets or parts, downgauge certain sheet metal, or change the quality of a substrate, we have business cases that show that the solution can be, one, a weight savings, two, a cost, potential cost savings, or cost neutral. So that information is dependent on the environment, but getting involved earlier is a much easier business case to justify structural inserts and structural adhesives.
Okay, thank you very much, Mark. So these were the questions that I came in, so I would suggest that I hand over back to Dan for the closing comments.
Thank you, Luke, and thank you very much for joining us today. We appreciate the time we've spent together. Above all else, I hope this session has given you the sense of the transformative role chemistry plays in the future of vehicle development. It's an exciting time to be in the industry, and we're happy to continue supporting you through the coming years. Look for an email soon with a recording of today's session. You can reference this material at any point in the future. Thanks again, and have a wonderful remainder of your day.